Hi, everyone. My name's Andrew Shebbeare. I'm here from an agency called Essence, where I'm the chief product officer. Our mission is to make advertising more valuable to the world. And clickers that work. I spent most of my time at university playing Snake on a Nokia 5110. If any of you remember this, it's about the best mobile phone ever made. But in between my attempts at high scores on my Nokia, I paid some attention to economics lectures. I'm not going to call myself an economist. That would be a brazen lie and very pompous. But I have been surprised in work and in life how applicable some of the lessons were that I picked up, particularly in my microeconomics lectures. And actually, it's what really got me into marketing and analytics, that I found economics and game theory were very good at explaining the relationships that brands have with consumers. And so I want to spend the time today talking about some of the lessons that economic theory might have for digital advertising, and maybe help us answer some of the questions that have come up today. In fact, I've heard the term behavioral economics and game theory several times this morning, so maybe it's relevant. And I thought it'd be helpful to look at some other industries and some of the pain that they've been through that might be analogous to ours. First of all, many of you have probably read or watched The Big Short, Michael Lewis's fantastic account of the 2008 financial crisis that pretty much brought capitalism to its knees. And there are a few things that I'll try and summarize his summary. There are a few things that kind of jumped out for me. Some industry cronies built products that even they barely understood and hid all their complexity behind a ton of jargon. And then instead of allowing anyone to actually look inside their magic black box, they used a bunch of totally inadequate quality metrics to assure themselves and their customers that what they were creating was good. They priced the products themselves, often pretty much on a whim, making their own markets with no qualified external auditor. And arguably at the root of all of this, they were very often the buyers, the producers, the auditors, and the sellers of these products that they'd made, creating a nearly impossible to manage conflict of interest for themselves. If that doesn't remind you of a programmatic trading desk, I don't know what will. The parallels are so stark. These problems aren't new. Economists have names for them. At the core of them, that fourth thing I mentioned is what they call the principal agent problem. The conflict of interest that arises when someone is paid to advise the buyer of a good and they are themselves selling that good. Economists also have a name for what happens when you buy a used car. It's pretty well known. It's called the market for lemons. And the problem here is information asymmetry. The seller of a good knows more about it than the person buying the good. And so they can hide a litany of evils under the hood. And again, if that doesn't remind you of pretty much every layer in the digital supply chain, I don't think you're going to enjoy the rest of my presentation at all. British people love to come to America and beat up on your healthcare system. But it's quite easy. This country has one of the highest per capita spends on healthcare anywhere in the world. I think possibly the highest by far. And yet, one of the lowest levels of coverage and public health in the developed world. There are a whole bunch of reasons for that, but probably the most important is that incentives are misaligned. Doctors earn money from both insurers and from drugs companies by prescribing treatment. Insured patients have little or no cost associated with consuming healthcare. And the result of that is moral hazard. Overconsumption, overpricing, and underprovision. Let's think about advertising misalignment of incentives. Media buying models that, as we've heard all morning, reward quantity over quality. Agencies who take money from the supply side as well as the buy side and are completely conflicted? Remarketing companies that operate a black box, over-prescribing their product to their clients who have no way of knowing what the most efficient level is. Publishers whose incentive forces them to litter their properties with ugly, lowest common denominator monetization tools, or to resort to business models that compromise their integrity. And clients who push down pricing in this whole value chain to the point of self-destruction. Healthcare is really difficult because it's very hard to measure better. It's very subjective, which is better health. But advertising should be so much easier than that. All we need to do is act in the best interests of the people who are paying for it, the brands. There's a strand of economic theory called game theory. You're probably all familiar with it. I'm sure you've all heard of the prisoner's dilemma. A little bit less well known is the tragedy of the commons. This is a situation that arises where lots of individual rational actors in a market doing the best thing for themselves deplete a shared resource to the point that everybody loses. Everyone wants to win, but actually nobody does. This is what happens when we overfish the seas. It's what happens when we pollute the atmosphere. And it is what happens when we install ad blockers that kill the internet as we know it. I cannot wait for the session on ad blocking. It follows me in a couple of minutes' time. And massive kudos to the team from AdBlock for being here and taking part in the conversation. I think that's fantastic. I've got one more of these, and then I'll kind of get to the point. I want to talk about copyright, because I think just like downloading copyrighted content without paying for it is stealing, I think taking a publisher's content without enabling them to make money from it is tantamount to theft. But just like the average torrent downloader, the average person who's installed an ad blocker perceives their choice to be completely victimless. The trouble is what economists call undefined or unclear property rights. It's not clear to the person installing an ad blocker who they are really taking from when they deprive sites of revenue. And in a way, who can blame them? Who does really own an ad impression? Is it the publisher? Is it the user? Is it the carrier? Is it the ad exchange or the network? Is it the ad blocker? Do they have the right to interpose themselves in that way? And this ambiguity doesn't only make it guilt-free and easy for people to take, it also gives lots of people in that value chain an opportunity to interpose themselves and, frankly, take liberties. We've seen lots of carriers around the world announcing their intent to start ad blocking. I think they have no right to do that. But that's just my opinion. Nobody's here to protect property rights. And worst of all, the operators of ad blockers are able to hold publishers to ransom, which makes me very sad. These are all markets that don't work well. They're broken. They're inefficient. And that's a shame because efficiency drives better returns and it creates opportunity. The word opportunity's come up a lot today. I think that's right. So I want to think a little bit about what constitutes a good market, what makes for an efficient market, what would we have to look like for digital to avoid eating itself. The fundamental principles of welfare economics have some kind of characteristics that we have of good, efficient markets. And the first of those is no transaction costs. Looking at our industry, transaction costs consume more than half of ad spend in programmatic. I think the IAB puts it at about 55% right now. That's insane. But I also think it's understated because it ignores the amount of spiral reselling of impressions that happens, such that many impressions are going through the same platform multiple times. The next is perfect information. If we had perfect information, this room would be empty. There is a ton of information that is lost from the point that an impression first enters a marketplace and the point that an ad is delivered. There is extreme asymmetry of information in this market, and that's giving rise to fraud, but it's also giving rise to undervalued inventory. I was fascinated by the presentation from Scripps and Cox earlier because they showed how much value was being left on the table. So there is opportunity here, not just a problem. Third, there must be no monopolies. This one's pretty easy, right? Our industry is trending into a series of vertical monopolies, each of them a walled garden. There must be easy entry and exit. This is pretty hard right now. The cost of entering the technology marketplace is enormous. The critical mass that's required to be a publisher is huge. And if I think about my business, I'm very pleased that I co-founded an agency 11 years ago, but I'd be pretty terrified at the prospect of trying to do that again in 2016. Finally, there must be local non-satiation of preferences. That's fancy words for everybody must know what they want. They must know which scenarios they prefer so that they can make informed choices in the market. And I'm not convinced this holds true because I don't think buyers have the information or the understanding of that information that's required to make intelligent choices at every turn. So I make it 0 for 5. Efficient markets are good and they are currently eluding us. So I guess a little bit more constructively, what's it going to take for our industry to pull itself out of the ditch? I've got some thoughts. First of all, I think it's about active choice. I think we must empower users to make active choices. Good advertising needs to be rewarded, bad advertising needs to be punished, and the audience must be the jury. This requires a more explicit and clear understanding between users and brands. Ad blocking as it stands doesn't do this. Ad blocking as it stands is a blanket tax across the ecosystem that doesn't incentivize any good behavior, no matter what fancy names we give to the initiatives to tax the publisher economy. Instead, users need to be given a series of options, each of which is self-sustaining and viable business for the publisher community, and each of which offers the right level of effectiveness to advertisers, and they can choose between those. Any stepping stones that help us get to that place, be they micropayments, be they blocking users, be they subscription models, any stepping stones that create choice, I think help us get to this place and are a good thing in my book. Next, there must be transparency. Agency guy standing on the stage saying there must be transparency. There must be transparency. It's a characteristic of every efficient market in the world. We cannot afford not to be transparent. We can be principals, we can be agents, we cannot be both of those things. In every single one of the talks this morning, it was clear to me that transparency is going to make for a more efficient market in the manner that we discussed. Transaction costs have got to come down. We cannot spend half of our ad dollars on spending ad dollars. This is beginning to happen, I think, through consolidation in the market. And as you start to have slightly fewer platforms involved in your buying systems, it gets a little bit cheaper. The trouble with that is the interplay with monopolies, because I think some of that consolidation has a dark side as well. There must be continual technical innovation. And of course, this is expensive, so I understand this tension among these factors. We've heard so much good stuff today about the smart stuff that people in this economy are doing to find real value. I think it's pretty clear that platforms and publishers can do really important things to grease the wheels for market forces. What Google did last year to basically kill flash banners is transformational for this industry, and it's proved the power of a platform. Mutable ads are fantastic. Anything you can vote. The migration towards cost per viewable impression that we talked about earlier is a really positive development for the industry. These things really help with market forces. Regulation, the R word, one that this room is typically terrified of. Every time that there's a spectre of regulation, we suddenly say, hey, it's okay, we're gonna self-regulate and invent an amazing new body to do so. And credit where it's due, those bodies have very often delivered some fantastic work. But there are some things that cannot be self-regulated. And in economics, we teach that, in particular, the enforcement of property rights requires external regulation. So just like we need to protect the oceans from overfishing, we need to describe who is allowed to block an ad impression, who owns it, and who needs to get the hell out of that conversation. Finally, I think everyone, and this is particularly true for brands, needs to start treating attention as something that is earned and not just bought. What if this doesn't happen? It's not the end of the world, it's only advertising. Some of you have probably noticed this whole presentation is in itself pretty much an example of the tragedy of the commons. Just like overfishing the oceans, digital advertising is soaring off the branch that it is standing on. But advertising won't die. Brands won't stop needing to connect with new consumers. And word of mouth alone will never satisfy their need to do so. So it seems reasonable to expect that brands will resort to channels that are harder to control or block. And probably what will happen is that we'll innovate around those and make them more addressable and more personalizable. And in 10 years' time, we'll be having exactly the same conversation about exactly these same forces in a different set of media. These are fundamental issues. I found today, so far, I know we're only halfway through, but incredibly encouraging in the head-on way that you're all tackling these problems. Unfortunately, I think that's not representative of the behavior of the industry as a whole, and I'd love to see that change.